Welcome. So yeah, I'm very, very pleased to have Tim here. Just before I give a bit of an intro, just briefly myself and then obviously Tim. I see a little bit of housekeeping here. So safety, we have the two extra doors here. If there is an earthquake, then it might be tricky to do the drop, cover and hold, but you can stay where you are and get instructions from, I think, red t-shirts, university people. And you're supposed to get at Craig Road, basically the core building in Craig Road is a 7-point. Now, toilets are just around the corner and different places in mining. And yeah, like this place here. So I think this with these UC Connect seminars, I think Margaret's sort of handing that. You can send an email to Margaret or to the website,
is it? It's on the UC
Connect
website.
Yeah, the UC Connect website, and you can sign up. Alright, so what do you think of?
Yeah,
so,
who are you?
Oh, unless I'm getting on now. Yeah, the extra work production. So, yeah, I'm actually in charge of the University of Canterbury Room to your research room. And, the situation with Mahi Peninsula, and there were five of former postgraduates who actually key positions. And Mahi Peninsula, it was pretty amazing, and one person just did it. PhD, doing guidance and actually, I think a couple of them actually said things like, we just made orbit, or we now have like theory separation. So this is coming from Canterbury Engineering. So I just have to say that, yeah, Canterbury Engineering has played a major role in the New Zealand space industry. So that's all. Tim, so yeah, it's pretty amazing to have you here. So
thanks.
I'm really hoping that, there might be a way of getting you back to and hopefully maybe getting involved with UC Rocket and coming to some of our launches, even though I have to say, like, our rocket is just a minuscule. Like, when you look at NASA stuff, you actually have a chit chart of rockets and it's just very tiny. Even the neutron rocket, which I don't think is big, it's 18 meters, just tiny. Compared to what NASA does. So, yeah, thanks very much for coming and
thank you.
Forward to it.
Thank you, Chris. So, I'm helping NASA build what will be the most powerful rocket in history. We had a successful launch yesterday, working with SpaceX, which was the most powerful rocket since the Saturn V, way back when I was little. So what we're seeing is a generation of launch capabilities that will support, first of all, return American astronauts and other astronauts to orbit without having to rely on other countries, and also to deep space. So especially with the deep space emphasis and the goals we have for deep space, we're gonna need a generation of very powerful vehicles to take us there. And so with that, let's just get started.
Humanity is on the verge of a journey into deep space. But before we can return to the moon, and before we can visit Mars, or any of the worlds beyond, we have to take the first step. First step into deep space. This is the Space Launch System.
So, before we go further, as you can probably tell from my accent, I'm not from here. So I did want to point out to you very briefly the organization of NASA that has a headquarters and 10 centers around the country around the U.S. with different functions, different focuses. All of them are involved in the development of SLS in some way. But the Center for Rocket and Propulsion Development is here in, of all places, Alabama. So the ground support and the ground launch systems are, probably know they're in Florida. And then the astronaut and the development of human habitat is led out of Johnson Space Center in Texas. But let me just ask, what do you think of normally when you think of Alabama, or do you think of Alabama?
Roy Moore.
Wow, he became famous or infamous all the way over here. Any others? Oh, very good. Well, it's funny that you mentioned that, because and it was, gosh, 65 years ago, more than 65 years ago, that a German engineer came to Alabama with other German scientists after escaping the Nazis, of course, and set up a shop in Alabama. There was a large military installation there, and enough room to test. And that's what put Huntsville, Alabama on the map. And it became NASA's center for rocket propulsion. And when people caught Wernher von Braun's vision of human space exploration, and the government caught on, that was the synergy for the human space flight, and that what took us to the moon. So. So I also, you know, want to address why we do what we do. Okay, and this is something, it's not in everybody's blood, but it's in many people's blood and in the drive of humanity to do new things, to go to new places, even at great risk. And I just put these examples up here that we can learn from and remember. It was several hundred years ago, I was surprised to find out that New Zealand wasn't even settled until, you know, about that time frame. And of course, it was more than 100 years ago that a group of Norwegians risked life and limb to go to the South Pole. And then, of course, he's famous around here, especially with his friend Tenzing Norgay. Edmund Hillary ascended Everest for the first time. And of course, when I was young, this was the big deal when we achieved the moon, human exploration on the moon. So what do you think, especially the younger ones that are here, what do you think? Give me some things that these people have in common. Yes. They were world's firsts to do something, to go somewhere. Anybody else? I would like to mention their predecessors. There were people that tried to achieve each of these and were not successful. And we learned from each one of these efforts, benefited and learned from those failures that we call failures, right? And there was loss of life involved. But we did it. So in my mind, it's not a question of if man will go to Mars, but when. And so I believe that we're embarking on a journey. So, the red planet, in fact, in a couple months, you'll be able to see the Mars directly overhead, if you get up early enough in this area, get up before the sun comes up, and you'll see it pretty much directly overhead. And you can, there's ways to find out when you can view it, but if you're interested, you can make that part of your dream. You know, just consider. So NASA has developed a strategy to get there, and really, not just to Mars, but to other deep space destinations to get humans there. We're actually in the initial phase right now, phase zero, where we are continuing research and testing on the space station. By the way, there are ways that you can view the space station and track it across the sky. It's called spotthestation.nasa.gov. Give it your location. It'll show you the times of day and the elevations over which horizon. And on a clear day, you can see it blink across the sky. So we're using the space station now to study the effects of prolonged exposure to space environments on humans and ways to mitigate those effects. In fact, there are twin brothers that are astronauts, the Kelly twins, that we're using. They volunteered to be guinea pigs for us to some extent. While one stays in space for a long duration and then comes back, they can measure the effects relative to his twin brother and learn. Also, we're developing standards for human habitats in deep space. The next phase, which will be in the 2020s, is to begin missions in what's called cislunar space, which is basically all the area between here and the moon and the moon's orbit and a little bit off the moon surface itself. And we're going to begin what's called a deep space gateway. Now that, the gateway will be a human habitat, but it will be on the off the surface of the moon, kind of in the moon's orbit, and can facilitate human missions both to the lunar surface and from there eventually to deep space. And that will involve development of the deep space transport in phase two, which will be another vehicle that will be used to transport humans from the gateway to deep space. It can also be used to transport supplies, but supplies can also be sent directly from Earth to destinations in deep space, such as Mars. Then finally, there'll be a set of crew expeditions incrementally from the gateway, a little bit further out at a time, and we'll be learning at each step in the way. And hopefully in the 2030s, depending on the level of funding, we will have reached Mars. So that's the plan. There's no plans for that. No.
And not either the moons or Mars either.
No, to return from Mars, there would be obviously need to be from infrastructure built on the surface of Mars. Yeah. So, what will be the world's most powerful rocket? Especially for the young ones, but hey, I still like Legos. My son loves Lego as well. Think of this as a pretty big Lego project, okay? So I'm gonna talk about the main components. So on the sides, you'll see in white, solid rocket boosters. Now, what we've done with SLS is reuse and extend the technologies and capabilities of the space shuttle. Okay, so the boosters are the roughly the same boosters that were used for the shuttle. Instead of four segments that were on the shuttle, there are five segments here, giving 20% more thrust capability per booster. And the avionics have been upgraded as well. In addition to those boosters, there are four main engines here at the bottom of the core stage. And these also are heritage technology from the shuttle. The shuttle had three of these engines. SLS is using four. And they've been very reliable and enhanced over the years, such that they are the most reliable and efficient engines of their kind, such that if you were to, if your 200 horsepower automobile engine was as efficient as these, it would literally fit in the palm of your hand, liter for liter. The core stage, this is the largest stage in history, and it has got, it's primarily space for the fuel tanks for the engines, but it also houses all the, or I should say, most of the avionics and the brains of the main part of the rocket that gets us out into the, away from most of Earth's gravity. And then the upper stage is a smaller stage with a single rocket that, after you escape Earth's gravity, is going to push the Orion capsule, which I'll talk about in a minute, it's going to push it past the moon. Then on top is an adapter that, for our test flight, we're going to actually be able to put about 13 small satellites in and make this useful for more than just a test flight. And then on top is the Orion capsule, which is, we'll talk about in more detail about that later, but it's the part that it's the only part that's habitable by humans. That's where the astronauts sit, on top of this humongous propulsion system. So let's just look at the scope of it, the size of it. As you can see there, it's roughly, if you lay it down sideways, it's roughly the length of a rugby pitch, and also about 8.5 meters tall. So what is that, about that tall? Tall as the ceiling? And the dry weight is between 2,500 and 3,000 metric tons. It's hard to envision a metric ton, but I like to think of it in terms of a Mini Cooper. Mini Cooper weighs about a metric ton. So that is the mass of this rocket. And what you're gonna see, there's two versions of this rocket that we'll talk about. This is the initial version for the test flight. Subsequent versions will be slightly more capable for cargo and crew. So you'll see that difference throughout these slides. So how much can SLS carry? Much less than it weighs, right? Because if you're gonna carry something heavy, you need a truck that's much heavier. That's the way it works, especially if you're pushing mass away from Earth's orbit. You need something a lot heavier. So we've tried to express it in terms of metric tons and elephants, okay, and compare it with the space shuttle, which has roughly half the capability of the initial version of SLS here. And we should make, after yesterday's successful launch of the Falcon Heavy, we should put that up here because it's a little bit less. It's about 10% less than the test version of SLS. And here's the power. It's difficult to explain power. So we put it in the context of the number of, or the amount of thrust you would get from a Boeing 747, right? So roughly 30 times that. And here's a little bit about the Orion spacecraft. Okay, because it's designed to be to provide protection for humans, it has to withstand a lot of temperature extremes. That's the hottest that it would be exposed to, but it also has to provide heat in cold environments and protect them from significant G's acceleration during liftoff and especially back in the re-entry. This is going to be similar technology like we used back in the day with the Saturn program. It'll re-enter with, and you'll see that later here, it'll re-enter with parachutes into the ocean. And up at the top here is a special device. It looks like a rocket. Well, it is a rocket. Because if something goes wrong underneath, this is a lifesaver. It will pull Orion off the stack to safety. I also like to point out there's a service module here, and it has a number of functions that it provides to the capsule that houses the astronauts, but that's developed by the European Space Agency. So this really is an international effort. Okay, how does SLS fly? This is the problem I work on. So I would like, I've got a someone who's familiar with a cricket bat to come here. I'll ask Theo to come up and illustrate. Now he knows how to handle a cricket bat, but we're not gonna handle it like this. We're gonna handle it like this, okay? Because, and you can see, it's kind of shaped like SLS with the boosters on the side, right? So Theo, why don't you come around here? And Theo's gonna balance this on his hand. Okay, and you got plenty of room to move around. Whoa, whoa. Okay, that's all right, keep it going. Keep it going, all right. So, what we see here is, that's a good job. Theo's brain interpreting signals, if you will, from the bat, okay? You can have a seat. Thank you. So Theo's hand and his eyes were interpreting where the bat was oriented, and those signals traveled to his brain and told his hand how to adjust to keep this thing more or less pointed in the right direction. Right, well, that's conceptually, that's exactly how rockets work, right? Regardless of size, there are sensors throughout the rocket to interpret where it's going, where it's oriented, and then we have computers to interpret that and adjust many times a second, because we want the rocket to go this way, not this way. And that's a key part of rocket technology, and I'm real glad to hear what's going on in New Zealand with that. Oh, I missed something. Let me go back, talk about what we've... Just to give you the scope of what we're doing in terms of what we're trying to achieve, for those of you who might be listening and can't see, I'm holding a globe that's about 25 centimeters in diameter, and we're operating right now. We've developed a lot of capability in low Earth orbit, right, and some in high Earth orbit, between roughly a couple centimeters and maybe 30 centimeters away from the globe on this scale. In fact, the space station is less than a centimeter off the globe in this scale. So what we're trying to do is extend our human presence back to the moon, which would be roughly from here to the back of the auditorium on this scale, and then eventually to Mars, which I believe would be close to the ocean from here, maybe a few kilometers, depending on which side of the sun you are, because sometimes Mars is on the same side of the sun as us, sometimes it's on the opposite side. So between roughly 2 and 6 kilometers away on this scale. So I just wanted to give you that as a frame of reference of how far we're trying to go relative to where we are now. So let's go back, talk about the boosters. So as I mentioned before, they are heritage technology, proven technology from the shuttle, and we've extended that here. I think I'm just going to go on to the, I do want to mention, there's more than 12 kilometers of cable in each booster. Since I'm an avionics guy, that's an impressive stat. They burn through 5.5 metric tons of fuel per second. And you can see the thrust numbers there, 16,000 kilonewtons of thrust. And they burn through the first 2 minutes of flight. So they will drop off into the ocean after 2 minutes, not to be recovered. NASA found that trying to recover components from the shuttle over the long term is just not cost effective. So they will eventually be artifacts for treasure hunters to find. So here is a test. We've had a couple full-scale tests of one booster at a time at our testing ground in Utah. I think I have to do this to get it started. So we tested them. There they are. Had one test at very cold temperatures, one test at hot temperatures. So these are a segment, this is one segment coming off the casting pit in at the rocket factory, the booster factory, I mean. And you can see they built that. Let me see if I can back that up. So what they did is they, you saw a building over the booster. And what they did is temperature condition it. When it's time for the test, they rolled the building back. And here you can see in slow motion the ignition of the booster. And there's a plug. There's a plug that protects the bottom of the structure. And you see the plug being blown out first with a shock wave. And then here in real time, you're going to see in a minute smoke and fire. Of course, now the test is with the booster sideways. When they're really light, we want them to go that way. And now you can see the nozzle at the very end. Here we go. You can see the thrust vector control system adjusting the nozzle and testing that out. We've had 2 successful tests for that. And again, that's going to keep the rocket straight. Okay, let's look at the engines. The engines burn through, each engine burns through, I believe it's 1,500 liters of fuel a second. They are they burn hydrogen and oxygen and produce water or steam. So we've had a number of engine tests that take place down in Mississippi, which is our engine center. Here you see him, ready for test. Crane picking him up into the test stand. And I'm pleased to say that all of these tests have been very successful. We're ready to move forward with integrated tests very soon. So what you see there is pure steam. Same kind of steam you make when you boil water at home. Okay, we're going to look at the core stage. Really, we're going to look at components of this core stage that are in production. So what you see here is the hydrogen tank, which is the largest component in that tall core stage you saw before. As you see there, it's going to carry 900 tons of liquid hydrogen. By the way, liquid hydrogen is very cold. So when they fill this tank up, it literally shrinks 15 centimeters this way and a few centimeters this way. So all of the connectors have to be designed accordingly. So here we're going to see some of the components of core stage going through various stages of production. So we're going to start from the bottom, I believe, and show the engine section, the smallest piece at the bottom. And it actually, this shows it going on a barge. It was shipped up. Oh, this is the test version. This is the test article. It was shipped up to Alabama because we have the facilities that can actually crush this thing. We put it through destructive testing to make sure it can withstand the loads that it'll see in flight. There's the hydrogen tank. And there is the intertank, the section that holds the hydrogen tank and the oxygen tank, which is there, shown there, the smaller of the two tanks. And that was it. So this is our test mission here. We call it Exploration Mission 1. This will not be manned. It will have Orion on it, but Orion will have test dummies, just like you might see in for safety tests in cars. So what's going to happen is, let me back that up and I'll just talk you through it. So we launch from Florida, right? It's going to take a full orbit around the Earth and navigate more towards the equator so we get more of the Earth kick, right? And then go out towards the moon. It'll actually go further past the moon than anything has ever been, any manned capsule has ever been in history. And along the way, it's going to drop 13 satellites that have various functions, various experiments along the way, and splash back down in the Pacific. So I feel honored and humbled to be a part of this project. You know, I've enjoyed building things since I was a little boy, really. And along the way, I learned math and science and was able to get involved with something like this. So I hope this really inspires you and whatever vision you have for life. Here's a quote from the late Sally Ride, the first woman in space. Talks about what she studied, math and science in school. She was always had that interest in physics and astronomy and chemistry. You know, I look back and I think, you know, I'm standing on the shoulders of of great people. My physics professor in high school was actually, he taught at the local community college and came to our little bitty school to teach teenagers physics. And I thought, and he sacrificed for that. You know, he didn't make money at this little school. And so many people like that throughout our lives have affected us in ways that, you know, we don't realize much of the time. So, normally we think of NASA, we think of astronauts. But there's all, every other function that you can imagine, from other designers, software developers, biologists, people that are geared towards laying out plans and operations. One of my favorite is space chef. Man, what a cool job to be able to design food. And you know, I was talking with Chris earlier. NASA actually has perfected a process of freeze drying food to retain nutrition, and that obviously is more convenient to carry into space. In fact, Theo, you got your thing? Yeah. Freeze-dried ice cream. So, all kinds of careers. Yeah. So, all kinds of careers. You know, we don't talk enough about how much NASA has impacted the medical field. But over the years, in fact, NASA has documented, if you Google NASA spinoff technologies, NASA has documented over 2,000 technologies that have been brought to the people at large. In fact, in the 1970s, there was a famous author who spoke to our Congress and testified about a heart surgery he just had at the time, and he credited four NASA technologies that were developed during the moon program as something that enabled this particular surgery. So we're not just, you know, scratching the itch to send an explorer somewhere. We're pushing the boundaries of knowledge. And when you solve problems that you didn't even know existed before, amazing things happen. You know, and if you're so inclined, I'd encourage you to go out there. And every month they put, NASA puts out a notice of a technology that's been made available to the public, whether it be, you know, something as utilitarian as a space blanket, or something that can save lives.
We will return American astronauts to the moon, not only to leave behind footprints and flags, but to build the foundation we need to send Americans to Mars and beyond.
Yeah!
Okay. With that, I'd be happy to take any questions. The date of the launch?
Number of launches and the lifetime of the rocket, of course, retired.
Oh, that is to be determined. Yeah. So this particular rocket, you know, we have the initial test version, and there are plans to evolve it incrementally. So the subsequent version will have a advanced upper stage. The version after that will have advanced boosters for more propulsion. What we're going to see with that is increasing amount of payload capability and an increasing, or I should say decreasing travel time, because especially in the context of mission to Mars, we're talking about hundreds of days for a manned, with current technology, hundreds of days for a manned mission to Mars there. So we're looking for ways to reduce that time. So what you're going to see over the coming decades is an evolution of these capabilities. This rocket will look much different 10 years from now because... Well, what we found, he asked about reusability. So what we found with the shuttle is that it just was not cost effective to try to reuse the components. I'm sorry?
Non-developed new technologies like landing back on land and stuff to reuse it that way?
Well, that's going to be proven out over time, whether that is cost effective or not. So you mentioned SpaceX. So you know, NASA is in cooperation with SpaceX, actually subsidizing SpaceX and other companies to experiment with these new technologies and to develop such that they can eventually become profitable over the long term.
And on top of what you were saying about reducing the travel time and also reusing the recycling, I was reading, I'm just saying to say from the book, because it might be wrong, that there's also a strong project funded by NASA on a magnetic plasma rocket that is not like chemically operated as a classic shuttle. Is this being taken into account for the SLS, or is...
Well, I'd have to talk with our advanced... We actually have a number of groups throughout NASA working on advanced future technologies, and I'm not too familiar with that one, so I'd have to get back with you on that. It'll be a different technology because it will be, like she mentioned, for the deep space propulsion. You know, right now we have chemical and electrical propulsion systems that are much different than this, right? The main focus of my project is to get us out of Earth's gravity. And,
compares this to Saturn V, the upload and what improvements we have made?
Well, the navigation systems are going to be much better, and we will have a much more accurate insertion point to different orbits. What that means is we don't have to carry as much fuel, spare fuel to correct. So that's one of the advantages. The other is just the eventual payload capacity is going to be much more with the second and especially the third version. Yeah.
You think?
Yeah.
rating the rocket is difficult, yeah?
Man rating?
Yeah.
That's right, and that's something we are helping commercial companies try to do to get through that.
My question is, by the end of this year, things are rosters up to rockets unrated.
So ULA and SpaceX are both unrated vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
So why are you unrating this when you could send your people on the rockets to meet the cargo from here?
Yeah. So the focus of the commercial crew effort that you're talking about, that NASA's partnering with these companies, is for manned missions to low Earth orbit. The focus of this is, and as it evolves, is manned missions to deep space. Now, what we believe is that there's obviously more of a market for missions in low Earth orbit that can eventually become profitable to not only NASA, but to those private companies. And so what we're doing here is a little bit different than that. Not as much market for capabilities that are designed for deep space launches and exploration. Say that again.
What fuels have you considered for?
Yeah, we've got advanced technology folks that are working on that. But one of the reasons that you saw that technology here for the core stage was carryover from shuttle, right? We wanted to reuse as much of those proven technologies that we had for previous manned space flight and carry them forward while we developed other.
Reliability thing.
Yeah, exactly.
First manned mission to Mars. Any idea how many crew there will be and how long they'll stay for?
No, the Orion capsule that you saw there has been designed currently to support travel for up to 200 days. That's the initial version for 4 crew members.
You mentioned phase one space gateway.
Mm-hmm.
What's it going to look like? Is there going to be a departure from the ISS? And will that take a number of launches just to construct?
Yes, it will take a number of launches to construct. And
what's it going to look like?
Well, I think, to be honest, the initial version is going to be a bit smaller than the space station. We'll have to build it up over time. But certainly that will have all of the core capabilities that you need, including protection from radiation.
So it's basically going to be a transient spot.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, so Elon Musk and SpaceX have a whole different program for getting to Mars, and SLS program seems a little bit different. So how do you sort of see them working together?
Well, again, it's going to, over the coming decades, it's going to be interesting to see how private companies can be profitable in deep space exploration and how much or if they can save NASA money by providing certain capabilities that are geared and designed for deep space versus capabilities that are optimized for low Earth orbit. So time, yeah, he is. Yeah, so, and you know, Blue Origins is the same way, except they're not relying on government money. So, yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how this pans out economically over the next decades. Yeah, yeah.
When do you think commercial launches will happen for, like, Apollo and all that, for Mars?
Well,
obviously not for a long time.
Yeah, well, they're talking about, they're focusing on low Earth orbit right now, obviously. And of course, Blue Origins is trying to provide that for joyrides, you know, for millionaires. So it's a really hard question of supply and demand at this point.
How many how many launches do you think could be sustained per year with the SLS platform?
Right now, projected once every year or two is what we're looking at, so not many.
So this will be quite a long
process. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. That's right.
The deep space gateway, having a manned deep space gateway, can you say what the advantages? It's, I'm sure, quite expensive and difficult. What are the big advantages to achieve a deep space gateway?
Well, I think the main advantage of having it there is to support multiple types of missions to Mars, to a near-Earth asteroid, to they've talked about going to Europa, moon of Jupiter, to investigate that, and also missions. It would make missions to the lunar surface much more accessible. So it would be a multi-destination facility.
What happens if the first
Say that again. What happens if the first test launch is not successful? Yeah, that's a good question. That is a question to be resolved if that happens. So you either go back to the drawing board, or you go to Congress. You would have to go to Congress, which I won't do, but explain why and explain the rationale for moving forward.
Good luck. You're an avionics engineer?
Yes. Well, in particular, there's, and I alluded to it when Theo was giving our demonstration, is that there are a tremendous number of data being transferred among those computer processes every second. Many of them are flight critical measurements that are needed to adjust the thrust vectors in flight. Some of them are important measurements that are to be collected for post-flight analysis to verify the models of what we expect to happen. But yes, we have. Exactly. So right now, we're modeling that based on. We've got some good history with the shuttle, for example, for that. Right, exactly. So my focus is trying to make sure that those measurements are collected in a timely fashion. I work with our guidance, navigation, and control folks to make sure they get what they need in time, because the more stale or latent your data is going into the models, the more they have to adjust and predict. And then on the other side, the actuators have to respond also quickly. So it's a tremendous timing problem.
And you're getting data for the commercial purpose as well?
Yes, that's right. Say again?
What about other countries you acknowledge might be working on some problems?
Well, I wouldn't be able to. He's asking about other countries' efforts and initiatives, and I don't focus on those, I'm sorry. I do know in general what they're trying to achieve, but there's been talk of China's made it a goal to start mining on the moon. But they haven't really progressed to a point to make that economically viable yet. Yeah.
It's just working together as a human species.
Yes, exactly. We are doing that. We have a number of, in fact, some of the satellites that we have on this test flight coming up are experiments for the Japanese Space Agency. And of course, I mentioned the European Space Agency is actually part of this project. So we are, you know, do work with international partners.
I'm going to go to the front part, but can people just keep this a single question so we can
Okay.
Yeah, as an IT person, what kind of technologies are used in the, like this, what operating systems, what kind of,
They're custom. They're custom, yeah.
They're all custom?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's an awful lot of work, though, isn't it?
Well, yeah, but it's a small amount of the total software development effort. It really is, yeah.
I'm just interested with the emergence of machine learning. Is that a technology that you use in your field, or is it likely to be a technology that's useful?
Not in my field at this time.
Just like a few years ago, I got a request from the supervisor to work on a hypothetical project to design a genome of machine cat, which is actually. So we tried with a group 5 person using a lot of bioinformatics tools, mass spectrometry. All is hypothetical actually, but we are really curious about the living, if there is any living organism in machine cat, about the genetics. So is there people working on that? What could be the genetic backbone or DNA?
Hopefully we'll find out more. It's hard to know right now, but with the existence of ice on Mars, there's always speculation. We will find out more. The question is, if we do find microorganisms there, were they sent from Earth by an asteroid explosion? I mean, there's just all speculations at this point. So that's one of the reasons we go there, is because we can send robots. Robots can do a lot of data collection, and NASA is obviously using that, but there's no replacement for being there. So if I could use maybe Skype as an example. My daughter lives here in Christchurch, and she's expecting our first granddaughter, and we Skype with them regularly. We collect a lot of data from them regularly, but it's not the same as being here. And I think it's the same with human exploration. And it'll happen one day.
Oh, it is actually 8 o'clock, so I'd be great if we could finish my talk.
Wow.
Just thank you. The panel is just amazing here and here. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me.